one. Let's give the Lord praise. As you can see, so please visit the Connect Desk. They'd be happy to go over that information with you. I just want to say real quick, and a little plug for Soul Purge, right? Yesterday was amazing, okay? It was amazing. And we just want to encourage you guys, listen, I'm so grateful to be in a house that honors freedom and believes in pursuing it, okay? So as you go through Grove Track, or if you've gone through it and need a tune-up, please come back. You will be blessed, all right? Anybody excited for the Word? This is going to be an amazing series. So if you will help me, let's welcome our very own Pastor Soso Okuma.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. We honor God. We thank God for His presence here. He's always graced us with His presence whenever we come. And we humbly pray and humbly worship Him. He has always shown up. Scripture says that the whole earth is His footstool. That means He pervades the whole atmosphere, but there is a particular presence of God, the sweet, sweet presence of God that settles on the place where people worship Him. When people really rend their hearts to Him, He gives special attention to those people. And so I'm just blessed and honored to be here today and to partake into this worship. I want to quickly emphasize, or rather just point out, that next week, Saturday, we have the activation team is doing an outreach. Kerry Town Center is doing an Easter egg hunt. But we want to go out there and declare the glory of the risen Jesus. This month is about the death and the resurrection of Jesus. It's not about an Easter bunny. It's not about any egg hunt. It's about the risen Jesus. And so we want to go out there and just show our presence and minister and pray over the old city. But the meeting here is at 8:30. We expect everybody to come, as many as are open and free or really have a passion for outreach. Please show up here at 8:30 in the morning, and we're going to dispatch at 9. It's a few minutes from here, and we expect that God will move and do His thing. Father, we thank You for today. We bless You because You're about to share Your heart with us, God, and You'll give us the capacity to receive, the capacity to retain, the capacity to apply Your Word, God, in our lives. And we thank You because transformation comes only from You. We bless You in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. This month we're starting a new series. It's understanding the nature of the Holy Spirit. Understanding the nature of the Holy Spirit. And it's going to be four. We're taking four of the expressions. There are a few more expressions, but we're dealing more with fire, wind, oil, and water. Fire, wind, oil, and water. Express understanding the nature of the Holy Spirit. I know that for us, especially in this house, the Holy Spirit needs no introduction. Everybody understands, or I've heard, the Holy Spirit. However, there still needs to be some emphasis placed on certain things and some corrections made about some misconceptions about the Holy Spirit, and some understanding and some revelation shared with us so that we can walk into a deeper relationship with the Holy Spirit. So there is a lot to learn. I know that we know a lot about the Holy Spirit. Some of us have been walking with the Holy Spirit all our lives, but I'm hoping that God will share new eating nuggets in His Word, in His relationship with us, that we can get deeper with the Holy Spirit. In this series we're working, we're going to be talking on the four different expressions. I call them expressions. It could be manifestations. But I am going to be talking more on the fire. The fire, the aspects of the Holy Spirit, or rather the manifestation of the Holy Spirit that we see as fire, or that manifests itself to us as fire. That's what I'm going to be talking about today. Now, Scripture says in the book of John 14:26. Jesus promised that He would do what? That He will send us the Comforter to teach us all things. And so if I probably take a survey, yeah, even though we've been working with Jesus, the Holy Spirit and Jesus and the Father a long time, most of us will happily say that the Holy Spirit is our Comforter. He's our teacher. That's mostly the function of the office by which we know the Holy Spirit. It's one of His functions, but that's not the only thing the Holy Spirit does. And one of the things we're going to be doing throughout this series is bringing us into the full realization of all the multi-faces, the multi-faces and multi-dimensions and perspectives of the Holy Spirit, right? So that we are not just looking at the Holy Spirit from one perspective, because then we don't get a full picture of who He is. But the Holy Spirit, in John 14, 26, Scripture says that I will send the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. He will teach you all things and bring into remembrance all things that I said to you. So the Holy Spirit was a promise by Jesus to the early believers, to the church, and actually the whole world, that He will send this Holy Spirit to us. And it will do what? It will comfort us. It will teach us all things. Actually, yeah, just as it will teach us all things and bring all things into remembrance that He has taught us early on. But if you look at all of Scripture, if you look at all of Scripture from Genesis to Revelation, you would notice that the Holy Spirit does more than just comforting us. It does more than just teaching us stuff. The Holy Spirit was part of creation. The Scripture says that, and He breathed into man the breath of life. And the breath of life is the Holy Spirit. In other scriptures, it calls the breath of life the Spirit from God. And so God, the Holy Spirit, doesn't just do comforting. It doesn't just comfort you. And we're going to get there. The Holy Spirit doesn't just comfort us. I know that we're very much, you know, okay with that the Holy Spirit comforts us and He teaches us all things. I'm not sure that we quite learn as much as we claim that the Holy Spirit teaches us, because it doesn't seem as though we're being transformed by the renewal of our mind daily. But in any case, the Holy Spirit comforts us and He teaches us, right? It comforts us and He teaches us, but it does more than that. The Holy Spirit was in creation, had business in creation. The Holy Spirit regenerates us. Nicodemus was told, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot what enter into the kingdom of God. So the Holy Spirit is responsible for the work of regeneration. The Holy Spirit anoints. And the Holy Spirit anoints us. 1 John 2:20. The Holy Spirit guides. The Holy Spirit empowers. The Holy Spirit sanctifies. The Holy Spirit bears witness. The Holy Spirit encourages. The Holy Spirit, I can go on and on and on. And we're going to be doing a lot of that as we go through this series. But I wanted to just quickly draw an highlight that the Holy Spirit does more than sometimes what we really recognize or we even pay attention to. The Holy Spirit does a lot for us. He illuminates our mind in 1 Corinthians 2:12, in Ephesians 1:16. The Holy Spirit reveals to us the things of God, Isaiah 40:13. So the Holy Spirit does a lot for us. He is pervasive in our life. You cannot live your life one second without the work of the Holy Spirit. It is impossible for you to live as a Christian, as a believer, true Christian, dissociative from the power and the work and the activity of the Holy Spirit. It's impossible. You're living a powerless life. You're living an ineffective life. The Holy Spirit is all that we have, is the fullness of God that was sent to us. Jesus, that's the fulfillment of the promise when Jesus was leaving. He said, I will send you the Holy Spirit. And it doesn't just come and rest on us for a season or for a time. It comes and it dwells in us. It comes and it lives in us. It's interesting because, you know, we some of us, if you look at it, the old scriptures, I want to just state this. The Holy Spirit and the Spirit with a capital S, which we know is the Spirit from God, right? So you would see in the scriptures, it would say the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of truth. All of these are attributes and connection or referring to the Holy Spirit. But if you look at all of scriptures, there are over close to 400 different depictions of the Holy Spirit. However, out of these close to 400, the scripture only mentions the Holy Spirit 3 times in the Old Testament. 3 times in the Old Testament as the Holy Spirit. So it will say the Spirit of God, right? Or it will say the Spirit. Or it will say and God's Spirit. Only 3 times was the Spirit of God mentioned as the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament. However, as soon as the New Testament came, we began to have, almost as though there was a new dawn, a new understanding, a new perspective of the fact that the Holy Spirit is not just the Spirit of God, which is the Spirit of God, but we came to almost like a new understanding that the Spirit of God is holy. He has always been holy, but we just started calling him holy, right? David was one of the three instances, he said, take not the Holy Spirit from me, right? And so in the Old Testament, you will see that the Holy Spirit rarely dwelt in anybody. It rarely dwelt in anybody. It will come and rest on the people. It will come and rest on the tabernacle. It will come and rest and show and move, right? Almost as though I'm equipping you just for this. And after that, I'm on my own, you know, and you are on your own. But when John the Baptist hit the ground, he began to prophesy of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus came and he prophesied of the Holy Spirit. And just as he was leaving, the Holy Spirit came. And the new language, almost nowhere else, almost a few other places where it says in the Spirit, but the reference of the Holy Spirit became pervasive in the whole of the New Testament. The question is, why? Why did we all of a sudden see God as the Holy Spirit? And previously, it was just the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God. It boils down to how we understand God. It boils down to our relationship and how we interact with God. Now, in the children of Israelites in the Old Testament, always saw God from a theocratic perspective. It was their king. It was their ruler. Right? And so every time they heard the Spirit of God or the presence of God, it was either out of terror or out of worship. It was either out of terror or what? Out of worship. So the Spirit of God had always existed, never changed. We only came into a new realization in the New Testament. But I hope and I really pray that we do not lose the potency of what it was always and is and always will be because we came into a new realization of who he is. Because theologically, we get very, very enthusiastic. This is the new dispensation. It's not the Holy Spirit, not the Spirit of God anymore. Well, Scripture says that he is the same yesterday. He is the same today. He remains the same forever. And so whenever your thoughts come and you want to drift and about to think, and when you read the Old Testament and it looks very strange stories to you, I need you to pause and say, God, what is it you are doing here? And then I don't want to miss it. I don't want to see you any different from who you really are. I don't want to see you any different from who you really are. So the Holy Spirit has never changed. From eternity, he has been the same, will be the same, is the same now, has never changed. Now, our interactions with him have changed because culture have shifted. Our understanding have changed because we've become smarter in certain sense, become dumber in certain sense. So we're interacting differently with him, but the Spirit of God still remains the same. God never changes. Has anyone seen the Holy Spirit? Has anyone seen the Holy Spirit? No one has seen the Holy Spirit. It is impossible for you to see the Holy Spirit and leave. We have seen the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. We have seen how God appeared in certain situations, but no one has seen the Father. Now, the Holy Spirit is God. The Holy Spirit is God. Let me establish that right now. And then we can go into a deep study about the place of the Holy Spirit in the Godhead, or if the Holy Spirit is God himself. But the Holy Spirit is God. The Scripture says that we serve one Spirit, one true God. There is no separation, you know, of the Holy Spirit from God. So the Holy Spirit is God himself. Now, no one has seen the Father. No one has seen the Holy Spirit. And I know that God takes some of us sometimes to deeper realms and deeper places, you know, dreams and visions. And sometimes, you know, the John the prophet says, and I saw the face of the Father, and his face was like a shining sun. Yes, it's a manifestation. It's a likeness of who he is, not who God is. No man can see him and leave. It's impossible. It is impossible scripturally for you to see God and leave. It is impossible. So what God does is It comes in ways that we can understand. It tries to show himself to us. It tries to interact with us. But even though God interacts with us in ways that we understand, God doesn't just use any indiscriminate method to present himself to us. I want you all to understand that there is nothing impossible for God to do. I mean, literally, God can, if he chooses, I don't want to give anybody any ideas, but God can do anything. Right? He can do any crazy thing. I don't want to limit what God does. But when I look at the scripture, when we look at the scripture, there are particular ways, particular symbols that God chooses to express himself with. And the question is, why did he choose those symbols? Fire is one of them. Wind is one of them. Oil is one of them. Water is one of them. The word is represented by the bread, bread of life, right? So there are particular symbols, particular things that the Holy Spirit chooses to represent himself with. These things are not upon chance. He did not just randomly pick any item and say, you know what, I'm just going to represent myself like an handkerchief and, you know, it's got the handkerchief. No. There's a reason he picked what he picked. There's a reason he picked what he picked, because they speak to our understanding. So you have to ask yourself, why then fire? Why fire? Why fire? No one has seen God. No one has seen God. I want to emphasize that to us. So the only way we know God, or the only way we come into realization, or the way we interact with the Father, or the Holy Spirit right now, we're talking about the nature of the Holy Spirit, are ways in which it chooses to manifest himself to us, right? The way it chooses to manifest himself to us. Now, these things, this fire, water, oil, and wind, these are not just artistic expressions. These are not just nice things. They are particular things that have what? Deep meanings to the way we understand and relate with the Holy Spirit. The fire has been one of the most expressive forms of God's revealing himself to us. Again, it goes back to what I said earlier on. If you read the fire, the Holy Spirit, and the number of times that the Holy Spirit revealed himself in fire or as fire or through fire, you will see more occurrences of it in the Old Testament than in the New Testament. And the question then is, and more than, I don't want to throw a number there because I've not done a statistical overview, but there seem to be more often than not when the Father reveals himself through fire or as fire, there's always a sense of awe in the Old Testament. Always a sense of awe. It's like the fire, the continuous fire that burns in the altar, in the tabernacle. And then now the priests have to go there and have to do things on schedule. Schedule, some people say schedule. But I'll say on point. So I don't lose anybody. On time, right? And so the priests have to what? They have to serve on time, right? And you go out of time, you lose it. You lose your life. You don't live to tell the story. But we have grace in this dispensation. And so we have lost some of the reality of the person of the Holy Spirit. Because after all, we don't know when we are in or out of the favor of the Holy Spirit. But we're going to be calling the Holy Spirit like we are with him all the time. It is grace that keeps us safe. Grace. I really wish I can do an exposition, a worthy exposition of grace, the work of grace. Because we don't know all that are in play, all the spiritual machinations that are going on daily. What are the functions of fire? The functions of fire. Now, fire does a few things for us. It keeps us warm. Some of us who live in the country, I love country life. I like to have a fire pit, natural fire pit, not them electric stuff and that thing that look like whatever. You know, real fire, real coal, you know. But, you know, smoke is getting some ashes in your lungs and, you know. But fire does that, right? It keeps us warm. What does it do? It cooks for us, right? It cooks for us. It does a lot of things. But two functions of the fire that is of high importance, or rather things that we really should focus on, is the purative and the punitive measures of fire. The purative and the punitive dimensions of fire. Those are the two ways that the Holy Spirit moves with fire. In the Old Testament, the children of Israel became very acclimated with the punitive move of fire. They came to understand it that if the Father says, don't step there, you don't step there. Because if you do, the fire licks you. The sons of Eli, these are people who were born with an ordination of priesthood. They were born into priesthood. There was no contention. You were a priest, you were born into priesthood. Nobody argues it with you. You go to school, they give you a name for a priest. You are trained as a priest. Your cloak is a priest. There is nothing that contends with you that you're a priest. But even them, even those people whose birthright it was to enter the presence of God, offered strange fire before God. God did not take a second before he licked them up. That is what the punitive effect of fire. We're understanding the nature of the Holy Spirit. I know that some of you are like, oh yeah, so what? Nobody a priest, yeah? The fire won't burn none of us. But you got to understand the Father that never changed. You got to understand the Holy Spirit that never changes. You got to understand who he really is. And so the fire of the Lord would sometimes consume people. I mean, they walk out of place, it consumes them. Amos 5:6, Numbers 11:2, several scriptures in the script, you know, in the Bible talks over and over about what the punitive dimension of fire. And so we need to understand that the Holy Spirit is still a spirit that judges. That is a dimension of God that has never changed. There is something that holds that judgment from eating us. That judgment has always been there, still is there. But there is an intercessor. There is an intercessor. Scripture says that we have an high priest of the order of Melchizedek, who is king and priest together, who constantly intercedes on our behalf, who constantly stays the hand of judgment from touching us. The punitive effect of fire. Scripture says in the book of Zechariah 13:9 is actually God just lamenting on how the children of Israelites have walked out of his grace and all the things that he would do. But in the last verse there, God still took time out to say, but a third of the people that I will put into fire, and I will refine them like silver and test them like gold. They will call on my name and I will answer them. I will say, they are my people, and they will say, the Lord is our God. So even in the Old Testament, God had grace. Grace is not a New Testament concept. A lot of us think it is. Grace is not a New Testament concept. The manifestation of grace changed when Jesus came to unbelievers, known people outside of the fold. But grace was still there. If it wasn't for grace, no man would have survived the flood. Noah and his family was an effect of grace. Because what we can focus on is the judgment. We don't focus on the remnant. We focus on the extreme, on the length or the extent of the punishment. But we don't focus on the transformation. We don't focus on the remnant, the people who God preserved. The people who got tested through fire and silver and came out pure as gold. Fire symbolizes the transforming energy of the Holy Spirit's action. The prayer of Elijah, it says, let God send fire. And whose word burned like a torch? Fire came down and burned what? The sacrifice licked everything up. That was the transforming power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit always existed. Always existed. Always. Now, we're going to talk about a few instances when categorically the Holy Spirit appeared as fire. And we're going to understand, what is it about those instances, those appearances that make it unique? Why did the Holy Spirit choose to represent himself in those ways? We've already established that in the punitive expression of the Holy Spirit, when it comes with terror, right? It comes to punish, it comes to judge, it comes to destroy, it comes to clean, right? But in other times, the Holy Spirit comes in a very controlled manner. Very controlled. You know, at times when we look at the scripture, the Holy Spirit appeared as fire, but the fire is not burning. The literal expression of fire, not burning. Moses, what started the whole ministry of Moses, what brought Moses into his mandate, into his God-giving call, was an expression of the Holy Spirit in fire. Scripture says, and he saw fire, and he noticed that though the fire was burning, the grass underneath, the land underneath, let me not assume that it was grass for sure, but the bush underneath, he said bush for sure, was not being burnt, was not charred. And so Moses looked and he says, let me go see that strange sight. Let me go closer and see that strange sight. And so the fire of God can burn or can be present in the fullness of its dominion, in its heat and everything, and not burn. And I think in this dispensation, that is the expression of the fire of God. That even though it is staying controlled and it's not burning, we think it has lost the potency to burn. We think it has lost the fervor to burn. We think it cannot burn. All it does is just warm us up. The Holy Spirit just comforts me. I need comfort right now. The Holy Spirit, will you come and comfort me? It is fire. It will warm you up. It can burn you up too. And this is not a doomsday message. This is expressing the nature of the Holy Spirit. It's true nature. We're going to talk about his nature in grace. But you got to know his nature in and out of grace. So that you don't misappropriate grace. The biggest issue we have in this generation is we are misappropriating grace because we don't know the work that goes into it. We talk about grace and all this theology about grace and sin. I'm like, you don't even know the work that consistently goes on your behalf for you to make an argument about grace. For you to even be able to talk about grace, you don't know the work that goes behind it. Because if you do, you some things you just be like, no comments. No comments. No comments. It's not worth it. But the Holy Spirit chose to appear himself as the fire twice, at least twice, without burning, to Moses. It transformed his life. To the early disciples. Scripture says, and the Holy Spirit came and it appeared like a tongue of fire, like a tongue of fire, and it was distributed to each one of them. Why fire? And why did it not burn? Because scripture says that when the wind blew, it was like a mighty strong wind, right? And it filled the whole house where they were, the whole upper room. So they felt it. But when the fire came, it didn't come with heat. Even though it rested on the head, it didn't burn. It was just a sign. So the fire can appear in very controlled, seemingly harmless manner. And oftentimes we tend to misinterpret why it even appears that way. There are five reasons why the fire appears like that. Number one, it proclaims the presence of God. It is telling you this is not just any kind of fire. You know how we've grown out, sometimes we have how we mix our culture with the kingdom or with the gospel. And now we say, you know, certain things that you do come back to you. This is a spiritual implication, but not, it's not directly that way that every time you do something, you get it back. That's not true. But we call that karma and the whatever they call it, you know, meats and all of that. But sometimes we feel like, you know, if we see fire burning somewhere, oh yeah, you brought it on yourself. You brought it on yourself. So what the Holy Spirit was trying to explain to people here is you can have fire without burn. You can have fire without what? Without destruction. And it's only the Holy Spirit, only the Holy Spirit that can present himself in such controlled manner. And some of us say, I have the fire of the Holy Spirit burning in me, but you're not controlled. You don't have the control to be in a place where you have the potential to burn and you don't burn. You don't have the control to be in a place where people see that you have the power. You can explode if you want to. You can pick up and everything and burn everything, but yet you are in a controlled way. You are just sitting there and not burning. It is a characteristic of the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit can be in a place where he can burn and choose not to burn. We talk about fire. You know, I come from a place where, you know, there's this particular sect, and it's a big movement right now back home. This is my home now, where I was born. I want to start reminding myself that all I have is in this country. If I lose it, I lost everything. My wife, my kids, my everything. I got nothing back home. But again, I said home, back where I was born. But there's a whole movement where people talk about when they pray, they spend time saying, fire of God burn, fire of God burn, fire of God, fire of God. I'm like, first of all, do you even know the work of the fire of God? Do you think it's your stove? You think it just burns for the sake of burning? Every time you're in trouble, you call the fire of God. Is that the only function of the fire of God? It is why, based on the understanding of the fire of God. So they look at it and they think that every time the fire of God is invoked, it has to come with destruction. Every time the fire of God is expressed, it has to come with destruction. That is not true. That is not scriptural. Matter of fact, even the places where the fire of God expressed itself in destruction, the goal wasn't to destroy. The goal was never to destroy. There were conditions before destruction happened. So it proclaims the presence of God. It lets us all know that there is the presence of the Holy Spirit here. It is counterintuitive to what we expect. Most of us will expect that when you see the fire of God, you will see burning, you'll see smoke, which is one thing. You need to ask yourself, if you see smoke, God, why is it burning? What have we done wrong? Where have we missed it? Because your fire don't burn except we have sinned. The fire of God don't just burn for the sake of burning. It doesn't just come to kill you. We are the handiwork of God. This creation is the handiwork of God. What will God love to do? Create something that just burns for the sake of burning? There is a reason it burns. So if you were in the place where the Holy Spirit is striking with destruction, the fire of God is burning, you ask yourself, why is it burning? Because the express presence of the Holy Spirit, when it comes at first, is not to burn. It's to reveal itself. It's to tell you the Holy Spirit is here. It shows the composure and the gentility of the Holy Spirit. This is something that we need to always remember about the character of the Holy Spirit. It's a gentle person. It is gentle. It is gentle in its expression. Even though it can burn and the fire of the Holy Spirit can fall and consume, but in nature, the Holy Spirit is gentle. And so when you look at the fire burning, Moses saw the fire burning, but it didn't char the plant, it didn't burn the grass underneath. What the Holy Spirit was telling him is you were being introduced to a gentle father. You're coming into a relationship with a king who has power but is gentle. You are coming into an understanding of who the Holy Spirit is and how he works. He is gentle in person. The Holy Spirit, when he appears as fire, is a seal of authority. And when he sat on the disciples in the early church in the upper room, it sat on there like cloves of fire. What it did, what tongues of fire was, it was declaring to people that these are my chosen ones. Remember, the fire burning on their head preceded every other physical act. It preceded the work of miracles. It preceded the speaking of tongues. That was the first thing that happened that showed what? These are my disciples. So the fire in a place is what? An indication that you are set apart for God. It is not for you to go rampant burning people. It is an authority. It is the stamp of God on your life. Number four, that's the seal of authority. And the fire is the consistent guide. I'm going to add this. The fire is the fire of the Holy Spirit. When it shows himself, when the Holy Spirit shows himself as fire, it's the consistent guide. Scripture says that when the children of Israelites were brought out of captivity through the wilderness, the Holy Spirit would consistently reveal himself like what? Like a pillar of cloud by day and a cloud of fire by night. Why was he doing that? To keep them on a course, to direct them, to guide them. And so he consistently was their guide, was their navigation. And I'll read Exodus 40:38. This is an interesting thing. It says, for throughout all the journey, the cloud of the Lord was on the tabernacle by day, and there was fire in the night, by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel. In Exodus 19, verse 18, Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire, and the smoke billowed up from it like smoke from a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently. Now, this is an expression of the Holy Spirit appearing as fire that the children of Israelites experienced. So for some reason, they were traumatized by this. For some reason, it stuck to their memory. For some reason, they never forgot about this expression. And so, later on, when the Holy Spirit wanted to encamp with them in fire, they didn't want anything of it. They didn't want anything to do with it. They remembered how he appeared on the mountain, on Mount Sinai, and the smoke billowed and it trembled, and they were like, we don't want any of this. But interesting is if you read Deuteronomy 5, verse 22, downwards, it says, these are the commandments that the Lord proclaimed in a loud voice to your whole assembly there on the mountain from out of the fire. So the goal of God appearing in fire wasn't to kill, it wasn't to destroy, it was to instruct, it was to reveal, it was to interact, it was to pull them any closer to himself. But they missed it. And oftentimes we miss it too. We miss what God is saying in our turmoil. We miss what God is saying through our trials and our tribulations. We so want to go quickly, want to go back to the comfortable place. We don't want to stay in the place of trouble or, yes, nobody wants to stay there. But you're missing the dimension of God. You're missing the whole dimension of God if you only want him to reveal himself to you as a comforter. Only in comfortable places. He spoke to them out of the fire and the cloud and the deep darkness. And he added nothing more. Then he wrote them, and then Moses wrote them on the two stone tablets and gave it to me. Or rather, the Lord wrote it on two tablets and gave it to Moses. Now this is Moses replaying this. Now, scripture says, Moses was speaking to them, and it says, when you heard the voice out of the darkness while the mountain was ablaze with fire, all the leaders of your tribes and your elders came to me. And you said, the Lord our God has shown us his glory and his majesty, and we have heard his voice from the fire. They acknowledged that they've heard the voice of God from the fire, which is an expression of the Holy Spirit, which is what he wanted to do. We heard the voice of the Lord from the fire. But wait. Today we have seen that a person can leave even if God speaks with them. I find this very ironical. I mean, listen to the statement. Today we have seen that a person can leave even when God speaks to them. But shall we die? But should we die? This great fire will consume us. How did it not consume you when he spoke to you from the fire? How did it not consume you when you came into realization that God can speak to you and you not die? Why do you expect to die if it already spoke to you and you didn't die? This great fire will consume us. And we will die if we hear the voice of our Lord, our God, any longer. Who told you your expiration date? Who told you that if you hear the voice of God one more time, you will die? How is it so that you just heard, you just testified, you just proclaimed that the Spirit of the Lord spoke through fire, you did not die, yet you think that if it speaks again, you're going to die? And for some of us, it's probably why we're so concerned and running away from holiness. You think you are incapable. You feel like it is something that will kill you. The Holy Spirit is not yet to kill you. It is not yet to speak to you only when you need comfort. The Holy Spirit is yet to help you remain holy, to stay on the mountain of the Lord. The fire is yet to consistently burn in you. It says, if we go near and listen to all the Lord, it says, you go, Moses, why don't you go up? Moses, why don't you go up and listen to what the Lord says? Then come and tell us what the Lord says. And we do this so well in this generation. We have elevated men, who are just giving the opportunity and the grace to speak to all of us the word of God. We have elevated them to the place of God and saying, why don't you go talk to God and come talk to us? Because we don't want to face God. We don't want to go into the place of fasting and prayer to hear for ourselves. We don't want to go into the place where God said, literally, I want you to move from there and come. And you say, Pastor, what is God saying? And when God tells you what Pastor is saying, you don't even do what Pastor is saying because it's not comfortable for you. I'm going to ask you, what is God telling you to do? Are you telling Moses to go up and go talk to God? You don't want that fire around you? You want to eat. Just comfortable eat. Set it to 72. You know what? I'm feeling a little cold. Set it to 74. Just enough distance. Just enough distance. That you're not burning. And you're not cold. I'm just there. Scripture says that you are lukewarm. I am going to spew out of my mouth. We need to be on fire for God. The fire of the Holy Spirit is not just something that stays in the distance. It's something that rests on you. It's something that lives in you. It's something that is a stamp of the authority of God in your life. And so you take it wherever you go. You don't take it off. You don't keep it in your drawer. You don't keep it in your house. You come with it wherever you go. The Holy Spirit does more than comfort. I know that this is something that we've been taught in probably all our lives in church. He will send us the comforter. And he will teach us all things. Are you really letting the Holy Spirit teach you? Are you really letting the Holy Spirit teach you all things? Because Scripture says the Holy Spirit will teach us all things. How come we still have not learned the same thing that the Holy Spirit is trying to teach us? How come we're not learning? Are we that dumb? No, we're not dumb. We're strong-headed. We're strong-headed. We choose what we want to believe. We choose where we want the Holy Spirit to have impact. We choose what we call extreme and what we call okay. We choose how we want the fire of God to flow. And the reason why we're able to choose that is because we're in the dispensation of grace. And the fire doesn't come with punitive characteristic. But it comes to purge us. It is yet to purge us. That fire is yet to burn us, to refine us like silver. The fire is asking that you go through it. It let it settle on you. And you be refined even like gold. And you come out like pure gold. And I hope that we are not so far away from understanding the punitive, and the reason why I started by expressing to you the difference in understanding of the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and now it was called the Spirit of God, and now God will appear, you know, like fire, and people understood him that way. And now everywhere we go, the Holy Spirit. I mean, people use the Holy Spirit so randomly these days. I mean, the Holy Spirit. Yes, it will teach us all things, but is it really teaching you that thing? That thing you just said, is that the Holy Spirit saying it? If you don't take anything away from today, just know that the fire of the Holy Spirit has the same potency it has always had. Throughout all of creation, that fire is a consuming fire. Scripture says that He is our God, is a consuming fire. So it has the power to consume. It has the power to burn. It has the power, the capacity to destroy. It has all that power. But because of grace, and in this season, the fire of God is purative. It wants to purify us. It wants to transform us. It wants to rest on us and consistently burn out everything that is not of God, everything that is not of the Father. It wants to take it out of our lives. I hope that we are not too far away removed from the punitive characteristics of the Father, that we lose sight, we lose understanding of the true nature and the true characteristic of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is gentle. The Holy Spirit is kind. The Holy Spirit is powerful. He's an awesome God. He is fire. He is a consuming fire. That's what Scripture says. It is a consuming fire. Yet, it settles on us like a tongue of fire. It settles on us like a clove of fire. It settles on us like fire that is just burning, but not burning the grass. Do not quench the Holy Spirit. Do not quench the fire of the Holy Spirit. Do not quench the fire of the Holy Spirit. Some of us, the fire burns, and we let it burn sometimes. Sometimes we quench it. For some of us, we've not even experienced what it means for the fire of God to burn in our lives. We've not even come into an understanding of that. The only understanding we've come into about the Holy Spirit is that it's a comforter, is that it just soothes you, is that the Holy Spirit teaches you all things, and you pray in the Spirit to energize your inner man. But that Spirit is your stamp of authority that you are a son of God. Scripture says that for those that are what? The Spirit that what? Those who are led by the Spirit are what? The sons of God. If the Holy Spirit leads you into all truth, that is the confirmation that you're a child of God. It's not by how much time you spend praying. It's not by how much time you spend in the church. It's not by where you go to, where you come from. If you are led by the Spirit, which is characteristic by the fire, note that fire can be in you. The fire of God can be on you and you still be gentle. Some of us are struggling with just the notion of self-vindication. We always think that everything is righteous indignation. You know, everything is righteous indignation. Yes, are you sure? Are you really sure? Because if you look at the Holy Spirit and the way He's revealed Himself, it seldom in this dispensation of grace expressed Himself with such punitive characteristic. He has always come to purify. Always come to cleanse. Always come to transform. And this is not a contradiction about the power of the Holy Spirit. There is something that makes the Holy Spirit more purative than punitive in this dispensation. It's the work of grace. It's the work of grace. But today we're not learning grace. We're learning the full characteristic of the Holy Spirit. We're learning the capability of the Holy Spirit, what it can do in any situation. So when we talk about the expression of the Holy Spirit in fire, that is some of what it can do. It can burn. It can burn. But we pray that the Holy Spirit will purify in this hour. That when the Holy Spirit rests upon this house, it will be to purify us. It will be to regenerate us. It will be to purify us like silver and like gold passing through fire. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Would you join me as we stand on our feet, as we just pray into this and just release ourselves to the fire of the Holy Spirit. Kindle the fire of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And some of us, if you do not have the communion, we're about to do communion for our guests. This is something we do in accordance with the Scripture. Scripture says that we should consistently remember the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ by eating the communion, the body, the bread. and drinking of the wine that represents his blood. So we're doing that today. It's grape juice, it's not wine. So we're doing this in commemoration of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So if you want to join us, we just ask that you do it in honor and you don't do it unrighteously. We're going to pray over this, and we're just going to, go into prayer and just release the fire of the Holy Spirit over each and every one of us. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to commemorate your death and resurrection. We thank you, Lord, for this command, this mandate, God. And Lord, today we take this bread, this wafer that represents your body. We take it, Lord, and we eat it, God. We do this in remembrance of you, of your body that was beaten, that was broken, that was chastised for our sins, God. We take and we eat in remembrance of you. We also take this blood, this wine, this juice representing the blood of your new covenant that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. We take it, we drink it, and we do this in remembrance of you. Father, we thank you for a honor, Lord Jesus, that you have bestowed on us, God, to remember you daily in our lives, to remember your work of salvation, to remember your move to surrender ourselves, God. We prayed in worship, we surrendered ourselves to you, God. We say that you churn new wine out of us, that you press new wine out of us, that you make new wine out of us, God. This is a process of surrender. It is a process of daily surrender to you, God. And so, Lord, we come to you with our hearts open wide, God. We come to you with our hands held high in surrender. And we say, Lord, that you will captivate us, God. That you will captivate us even as your fire captivated Moses, God. You will captivate us, Lord, in our burning bush, God, in the places, Lord, that we need to be captivated, in our places of distraction, in the places where we've not paid attention to your fire, in the places where you were calling to burn in our lives, God, and we've not paid attention, that you will captivate us, God, that the strangeness of your move, the strangeness of your presence will captivate us. It will pull us into you, God. It will pull us into you, God, and we will release and surrender ourselves to what you are doing in our lives, God, that your fire will rest upon each and every one of us in this house, that the fire of the Holy Spirit, the dimension of the Holy Spirit, one of the ways in which the Holy Spirit manifests himself will be evident in our lives, that we will have the characteristics of the fire of the Holy Spirit, that it will rest upon us, each and every one of us, stamping your authority on us, stamping, oh Lord God, the authority that we are firebrands, God. We are children of yours. We are children of the Most High God. Let your fire rest upon us. Let your fire rest upon us in this place. Let your fire rest upon this church. Let your fire rest upon the whole church. Your whole church, God. Your whole church in Cary. Your whole church in North Carolina. The whole church in the United States of America. The whole church in the North Atlantic. The whole church in the whole earth. The church in the whole earth. Let your fire rest again. 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 Let your fire come. 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 Everywhere we have quenched your fire, Lord, let it be a kindling of your fire, God. Let your fire be rekindled. Let it come. Let it come. Let it burn, God. Let your fire burn out everything that is not of you. Everything that is not of you. Everything that is not of you. Let your fire burn away. Let it take away from us everything that is unjust. Everything that is unholy, everything that is ungodly, let your fire burn it out. Lord, let your fire settle on us. Let your fire sit on our lives. Let your stamp, your approval, let it sit on us. Let your fire purify us. Let it purify your church. Let it transform us. Let it test us. Let it test us even like silver, like gold, as it passes through fire. Lord, let us pass through your fire, God. Our lives will be transformed. Our lives will be transformed. Our lives will be transformed by the presence of your Holy Spirit fire. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Let your glory come down. Let the wind blow. let your fire fall, let your glory come down. Let the wind blow, let your fire fall, let the glory come down. Let your wind blow, let your fire fall, let your glory come down. Come down. Come down. Come down. Lord, we just thank you, Father. Thank you, God, that we're going to weigh our words in this season. And as we cry out for your fire in our lives every day, God, let us know the full weight of that, what it means to be a seal, what it means to be someone who represents the kingdom of God. Lord, let the fire of God be upon us, not just in our gifts or in our expressions, but in authority, God. May God see the fire of God in us and upon us and repent. And repent and say, I want to be like Jesus. I want to know this God that you carry. Lord, let our fire not just warm people up and cuddle them, but let just the presence, not what we say, not beating anybody over the head with the Bible, but just the fire of God, the reverence. Let the holy fear of God arise in this hour. Let the holy fear of God arise as your fire manifests in the nations, in the earth, in your churches. Lord, let there be trembling in our souls as we encounter the fire of God. As we press into the fullness of God, let us not pick and choose what we want to experience or what we want to feel, but we want the fullness of God so that we may walk humbly before you. We may walk humbly before you in the name of Jesus. Holy. You can go back to that. We're going to do offering. I just want the worship team to sing that through. Go ahead and those that are going to be collecting the offering, men, you can come up. David, you can sing that through us. We want to just cry out that the whole of God is holy. Sing it through again. Yeah. Dismissing.
Holy,
are you Lord? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Holy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Holy is the Lamb.
Holy is the Lamb.
Holy is the Lamb.
Holy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Amen. We bless you. We release the fire of God to be in you and through you and around you. We just declare that this will be a fruitful week, that this will be a week of encounter. We just declare fruitfulness even in the month of April. We declare encounter in the month of April. Let what the Lord has begun today, let him complete it, let him finish it. He who has begun a good work in us is faithful to complete it. So we thank you for the deliverance. We thank you for the word. We thank you for the fire of God. We honor you and we bless you. Guests, first-time guests, would love to meet with you in the cafe.